So, how can you tell if an author is truly great and if you're really a true fan of their work? There are about a thousand ways you could do this, but one really important one and special one, I feel like, is when you finish their last book that they ever wrote. And you're just really, really sad because you want more. And that's how I felt after finishing the final Jane Austen novel. So, welcome to Relish Books. This is the sort of final review where I'll be talking about Persuasion, but I am going to make another video where I rank them according to best written. And according to just my favorite, like my favorite stories. And then I also might a little later on do a video on Lady Susan, her very first novel, which is very short and isn't usually really regarded with the others. I did start it when I was really young, and it was at like the height of my Jane Austen fandom, and even then I just was not hooked at all by it. I was kind of immediately put off, but for the sake of these videos, and someone requested that I do it, I will do that at some point if I get a copy. So I think I have gotten the order straight now. I have been confused multiple times throughout my readings from the little introductions at the beginning of the books. But Persuasion was the final complete novel that Austen wrote. He was working on some others, but this was the final completed one. And the whole confusion about Northanger Abbey is also explained because it was published in a single volume with Persuasion 5 months after Austen's death. But that's just because it hadn't been published before. It had been written long before. So I'm pretty sure that, not counting Lady Susan, the order of her writing the books was Northanger Abbey, Sense and Sensibility, Pride and Prejudice, but she was also writing Mansfield Park, kind of back at the same time as Sense and Sensibility. So that one's a little confusing, but it wasn't finished until after Pride and Prejudice. Then Emma, and finally Persuasion. So, kind of the question here is, Emma, I really felt like the writing was so good. Is Persuasion better? Some people have said that Persuasion is her best written work because it was her final. And here's the thing, I've always been very against that theory because, or that idea. Because I don't like Persuasion as much as the others, or I thought I didn't, but rereading it, I did really like it. And something that's been so nice about rereading all the Austen books is that I had it in my mind that when I read them years ago, and I had reread maybe a couple of them and bits of them since, but when I read them years ago for the first time as a teenager, I was so caught up with them and so excited about them. And ever since, I've kind of had in my mind that it was almost like a phase that I was just in the right mood for them at that time, and that if I went back and reread them, they wouldn't be as good. And maybe that was partly because like Pride and Prejudice, I had reopened and read bits of, like, comparing it to the BBC movie. And I was kind of disappointed in some of it. So maybe that's partly what it was. But I have been so happy to reread them and find that that it was not just a phase. She really is that good. She is amazing. But Persuasion. I am not gonna say that I like it better than Emma, but it is really good. It's better than I remembered. Again, I think I was comparing it to a movie I saw of it, which I didn't really like very much. And to be fair, the movie was actually pretty good, like, as far as how closely it stayed, like, stuck to the book. But Captain Wentworth was really, really, really blah. He's supposed to be, you know, the whole thing that makes Anne attracted to him and love him is his very warm, open personality. And that's, like, the opposite of the guy in the movie. He's very cold and very reserved. Those are the exact manners that Anne didn't like in people. So, I really don't like that. But, the writing is super good in this one. Jane Austen had definitely gotten to a point where she really, really knew her craft, like, inside out. Her character development is really good. This book is a lot shorter, but you don't feel like it's really missing anything by being shorter. And I would also argue that even in this short book, this Anne is possibly Austen's most complex heroine. And that is what I really love about Persuasion. And something that I loved about it, even from the first, it's maybe not as fun as some of the other ones. It's maybe not as romantically heartwarming or whatever. But the idea of this book, I think, is so original, and I love it so much. This idea about a person's personality. The name Persuasion, I think, shows a lot of maturity as an author. If you look back to her her earlier works, like her first book is called Lady Susan, you know, named after her main character. That's pretty basic. And then you have, like, Mansfield Park and Northanger Abbey are both the places. You have Emma, which is also a main character, but it's nice because it's, like, a nice little short one. I think that is actually a really good name. Sense and Sensibility, Pride and Prejudice, those are, like, cool-sounding names. They're fun. But Persuasion shows a depth and a subtlety in the name that works with the plot in such a neat way. I love the idea that the book is exploring about the virtue, or whether it is a virtue or not, of having a persuadable nature. Of course, the story is that Anne and Captain Wentworth were engaged when they were young, but she allowed herself to be talked into ending the engagement by the woman who is essentially her stand-in for her mother. Anne's father and older sister are really silly, kind of terrible people. And they were against the match because all they care about is rank and birth and wealth and blah, blah, blah. And Catherine didn't have those things at the time. So they were against it, but that wouldn't really have mattered, except the one person in Anne's life that she really has to look up to and be guided by really strongly advised her against it, and she listened. And that sounds kind of awful in a way. In our society, largely because of books, I think, books and movies and all that, we kind of have it in us to put romance, to put love above everything else. Like, if you love somebody, that's what comes first, above any ties of duty or connections to family or whatever. And it's kind of always taught to us that the right thing to do is to throw away everything else if it's for love. And what's so interesting about this book is that it's kind of made out as if Anne did the right thing, as if her choice was correct, but it was her advisor, Lady Russell, who was wrong, instead of Anne's being wrong and listening to her. Which I don't know if I fully agree with all that. It's kind of hard to sort through these things. I think it's just a case of bad luck, almost, because you see over and over in Jane Austen's books you see these people who make very bad marriage choices, and it's like they wouldn't listen to anybody. And if they had just listened to their friends and advisors, it would have been far better not to make this marriage, but they just threw it all away. And there's really bad consequences. But, so it's like Anne does what she should do. I'm not really sure about that, but in listening to her advisor, but it actually, in that case, would have turned out far better for her if she had just married him, because everything that he hoped for came true. He made his way in the world very quickly. He rose through the ranks in the Navy. Everything that he had kind of promised her and prophesied for their life together went ahead and happened just the way that he said it would. And Anne is left at home in a very unhappy home situation to kind of hear about these things from afar and think about how she would have been so much happier if she had married him. And maybe the one thing that I kind of disagree with in the book, that I disagree with Anne, I don't know, it's hard, because like I said, she, even to the end, kind of feels like she made the right choice in ending the engagement, because she said it would have been more miserable for her to go ahead and do it against her conscience. And if that's the case, it's like, okay. But I feel like a real person would have had more regret and more feeling that they were wrong. Because kind of to the end, she thinks she was right, and she doesn't really, she thinks that Lady Russell was wrong, but she doesn't really blame her for that. Which I think is really interesting. I say that I disagree with it, meaning that I think I would feel differently. But it just kind of adds to the whole, this very interesting concept in the book. And then, you know, Captain Wentworth, when he sees that she was able to be advised and persuaded, that she had a mind that was able to be persuaded, obviously he was very upset about that, and that's very fair. And he was so upset about that that he decided that what he wanted in a woman, all he really cared about, you know, she has to be like a good woman or whatever, but the thing that's important to him is that she has a firm mind, and when she's made up her mind, she won't change it, and she won't listen to people. And then that kind of is turned around when he sees this other girl that he's maybe somewhat interested in, being unpersuadable to the point of being like really obstinate and stubborn. And he realizes that it's a good thing to be able to listen to people, to be able to accept advice. So it's just a really, really neat concept in a book, and something that I think is done so well. I think she's smart in making it kind of a shorter book, because this concept doesn't need over-exploring. And yeah, I love the character of Anne. I really feel like Jane Austen had arrived when she does Anne. Again, I don't necessarily like this book better than some of the others, but I think there are qualities, just qualities of maturity to the writing. And if you look back at all her other heroines, Anne is kind of this mixture of them all. She does not feel weak or timid in any way, and yet she's not like a super strong, open, fearless kind of personality like Emma or Elizabeth. But she's not like super timid and crying all the time like Fanny. She's just a very mature person. And I think part of that, you have to remember that she's older than a lot of these other heroines. You know, you look at, like, I read this one right after Northanger Abbey, and that heroine is 17. And Anne is 27. So she has had time to mature and really have her character grow. And I think, I just think she's a great protagonist. She's steady and calm without being at all boring. She has a depth of feeling and romance and all those things. She's just a really well-rounded character. And so I really appreciate that about her. If there's a problem with this book, it's the same problem that I've complained about in multiple of the others, and that is the very rapid wrap-up at the end. You're getting towards the end of the book, and you're like, okay, there's only a few pages left, and none of this has been concluded, and so by then, you kind of know it's just going to be the very abrupt ending that some of her other books have seen. I do appreciate you get a little snippet more of romance than you do in a couple of the others, in that you get Captain Wentworth's letter, and it is a good letter. Very, very properly romantic. It's very satisfying, but that's all you get. Their conversations afterward, you get pretty much none of. Again, a very quick wrap up. You get a little bit more of them just talking about kind of the past and some other things later. That's not the only thing that's rapidly wrapped up either. There's been this whole struggle the entire book of this kind of imposter in their family. Mrs. Clay is trying to ingratiate herself into the family and hopefully get the father to marry her. For money and all that. It's been this thing that they're dealing with the whole book, and at the very end, that's just kind of tucked away. Like, oh, she went and was with this other person. So if I have a criticism, it's, again, that same thing that Jane Austen seems to feel that once the main drama is drawn to an end, there's no reason to explain anything. And I can appreciate this when you think about lots of novels that over-explain everything. Like, there's an ending, and then there's an epilogue, and then there's another epilogue, stuff like that. Most authors really struggle with not knowing when to quit. I feel like Jane Austen quit a little bit too early in most of her books. Or not even that she quit too early, like, we just need a little more, a little different. If we could have just had some of the conversation that Anne and Captain Wentworth have as they're walking home together, if we could have just had that, I would be satisfied. That's kind of a common problem. But other than that, it's a great book. And there are some super frustrating things about it. There are some frustrating characters, as always, some horrible people. Both her sisters are really awful. Her father is awful. But it's kind of funny, too. And they're not as horrible as some of the other people. Some other characters, you can deal with them a little better, I feel like. It is an amazing book. Really, really good. I had this really, a very real sense of sadness when I finished it. It was like, oh, that was the last one. I want more. And on that note, I'll be making, a video where I rank them a little bit. After that, I'm going to switch and do 3 Edith Wharton novels on Fridays instead, hopefully. I just started The House of Mirth. I think I like it so far, but I don't really know anything about these books, so if they turn out to be terrible, I will switch to something else, but that's probably what I'm going to be doing next. So, thank you for watching. I will have my ranking video out soon. If you've ever thought that, like, Jane Austen is overrated, or if you've heard people talking about her in that way that they do, like in modern shows and stuff, They talk about Jane Austen. I hate this so much. They talk about Jane Austen like she was amazing and she was brilliant because she was a woman novelist. And they kind of assume these things about her and attribute a lot of characteristics to her that are modern ideas being pushed on her. They talk about her, you know? It's all about, oh, Jane Austen. Jane Austen would have thought this and done this. And it's like, have you even read her work? Have you read what she believed in? The kind of people that her characters were? If you actually cared about what she was saying and not just, oh, she was a woman author, I don't think that you would be such a fan. Yeah, I hear characters doing that, especially, like I said, especially in shows and stuff. And it really ticks me off because I feel like they're undervaluing her. They're making her into something that she's not. And they're kind of taking away her true merit and replacing it with some other idea that they have. And it really annoys me because her books are incredible. And they speak so much goodness. And yeah, there are definitely flaws of the time that come through. I talked about that a little bit. Those prevalent in Emma, as much as she criticizes the idea of birth and rank, she criticizes it, but at the same time, you know that she believes in it too, to a certain extent. It's just her time period. But for her time, she was amazing, and she should be remembered for what she really was, not some other idea that we put on her. So, anyway, if you haven't read these books, definitely read them. Don't just believe what you hear people say about them one way or the other. Read them for yourself, and I think there's something there for everybody. So, thank you so much for watching. I will see you next time. Bye.